you must all be wondering why are we even talking about this topic at an automation testing conference. Is there anyone here with any such questions? Yeah. So before we move ahead, I'd like to introduce myself. I've been testing from 2005, and I recently started blogging in 2012, and I saw myself that from 2005, while I was working in multinational corporations or with startups, I saw that I was not following a process which the others were tending to follow or they were forcing me to follow. So I kind of felt myself that I'm being a rebel against these processes. But there were a few things which I later in point in time learned that some of these are essential, and this helped me become agile. So agile for me means flexibility in what I do rather than follow what is being said as those commandments. So that is about me, and I'm also the editor at womentesters.com. I don't know how many of you have heard about it. We started this magazine in 2014 in association with Testing Circus, another magazine. And this is a quarterly magazine which also takes articles not just from the ladies but also from gentlemen. We also have a guest post section wherein you can all feel free to contribute. And this is my blog address, Chronicles of Testing. You can find me there writing on topics that interest me and the problems that I face and the resolutions that I find. And my tweets mostly on testing are at RJ, and I've been a speaker at Star West. Inherently, we have all been explorers. So if you see the pictures here, this is Sacagawea, Vasculogramma, and a kid over here. So at home also, if you have kids, you would have found them doing something, and you know, some surprising element is there, and they are happy that they explored something. So how many of us have been in such situation in the span of your career? You found something and you were happy. And you found something by yourself and not by the test cases that were written by others. So is there anyone here that were really happy that they did find something in their own and by not following few test steps that were written by others? What made you happy, if I can ask you? Come in the front. So you learned something new and that made you happy. How many of us are happy when we learn something new? What was it? What did you learn? Cycling, swimming? Anything, it could be anything, right? You learned it for the very first time and you were overjoyed by learning it. So I feel that testing is all about learning. I don't know what makes the money, or as Brett said, where the money is coming from. I don't care about where it is coming from or where it goes to, but for me testing is about learning. So learning about what? So even before we understand exploratory testing, let us understand what testing is. because it's very important for us to even segregate testing as ET, automation testing, and some very new term that I heard today, SecOps engineer, manual automated testing. I'm still confused with all these terms. So even before we get ahead with exploratory testing, let us understand what testing is. Testing is about giving information which is valuable to your client, or it could be any user. You yourself can be a user in this case. So how do you even get to know that, you know, I need to provide this information? Or what is your path when you're looking for information, and it could be an application that you downloaded and started using? So what do you look for in it? What you're trying to do is you're trying to understand the product, or trying to learn the product. That's what you're trying to do, right? So you're seeking information. So how do we seek information? Sorry, you didn't talk to the developer. How we seek information, right? So I'll move on to the next slide. When I was introduced to exploratory testing, they sold me this and I bought it. And as you can see, when I'm interviewing some testers, when I ask them what exploratory testing is, they give me some definition, which, you know, I still can't buy it, or it's all available on the internet and anyone can go and read it up. But still, the definition that they gave us, exploratory testing is something which is done after, you know, your test case execution is done. So I would want at least two or three of you volunteers up here to come up and say what exploratory testing means to you. Can I have one or two volunteers, please? Anyone who has heard of exploratory testing before? Do we have anyone in the audience? Can you come? Heard earlier as well that someone said we are exploring, and someone said playing around, and even now Prabhu said it's about playing around. So most of us think that exploratory testing is synonymous to ad hoc testing, and I have even heard something called monkey testing. I don't know what it is. And so, does anyone know what monkey testing is? Does this what the others think as well, or do you have a different? Okay. there's another definition which is similar to smoke testing, as you said. But I think you are in the right workshop then, because it is not jumping around, neither monkey, nor ad hoc, nor smoke testing. Exploratory testing is very well structured. And as you can see, this, the term exploratory testing was coined in 1883, before most of us were born. And even today, we are still finding it difficult to put it into words on what exploratory testing is. So doesn't this make you think that we are not trying to learn what it actually is, and we are assuming our own definition? I think we are trying to do that. So as you can see, it is also an approach to learning. And while you do that, you're parallelly also you're trying to create the cases. You don't call it cases, but the term here used is ideas. So when you start writing your test cases, you are told to write them, and then you are asked to send it for review, and there is also a sign-off. So after that sign-off is done, it's like a seal which is stamped on your test cases, and you're not supposed to touch it. It's so sacred that you only touch it during your execution. And how many of us have felt the need to, or the urge to add some more test cases or test ideas? And we're not allowed to do that. Or we're questioned, why didn't you think of this idea earlier? No, it's already reviewed, it's signed off. Why are you even coming up with this idea now? And the main reason for this is you're supposed to estimate. And most of us forget that estimate is just nothing but guesstimate. You're guessing a number and providing a value that, you know, we'll execute these test cases in this much amount of time. So, but when that number increases or decreases, your manager or you yourself can panic. So here the approach is not about sealing and signing off these test cases, but while you are involving yourself as a tester, you start preparing ideas. You collate them, you put it in a mind map, or it could be on an Excel sheet, it could be anywhere else. So irrespective of where you capture them, you continuously keep adding on to them, and you're not signing off and telling that it's over and done. So it's a parallel way of learning, also forming your strategy where you learn, and also test execution. So it involves all of this. And here are some myths about exploratory testing. As you said, it is unstructured, we don't know what we are doing, but we are clicking somewhere, and if we are lucky, we do find bugs and we report it. And here's another funny definition that I heard. I was doing the same presentation earlier in 2012, and since then the definition has remained same. So I asked this person, what is exploratory testing? And they told me that it's something which is done after the test cases are executed, and if they have time to do that. So the definition from 2012 to 2016 has remained. Even today I'm interviewing people, testers, and they give the same definition, that it is unstructured. But it's not so. And yeah, it has no test cases and there is no documentation, which is again not so, and we'll see how it is not done. Here is another perspective of what exploratory testing is from James Fine. He's one of the exploratory test practitioners who is even today practicing exploratory testing, so I thought it's better to include this. As a reference, maybe you can go and read it on your own time. So coming to session-based test management. So this is the approach which is used or which is being followed to exploratory testing. So what is session-based test management? So instead of following a test cases, you come up with a mission for, say for example, it is also time bound. So you don't, test for 4 hours or 8 hours. I was in an organization, an MNC, where, you have been given the last 2 days of your sprint. Say if it is a 15-day sprint, the 14th and 15th day you're testing, and the first 13 days you're on a different project. How many of you are in this situation? Because you're free from day 1 to 13? That's not right. True? So how about you? Are you free on day 1 and 13? Some of the projects. So that should not be the case. When you are involved, you have to be involved in Agile again from day 1 to 15. But even I have faced that I am involved only in day 14 and 15. And what I was doing is, in that 16 hours, you're running 120 test cases in 8 hours, and you have to meet that target. So what do? You don't look here and there, but just follow the test cases as it is. Even the test data is there in your test cases. So you're not even allowed to try any other different set of data. So you're sticking to that, and at times feel frustrated that, okay, when do I get to test what I think should be tested? So here is your chance to do that. And I'm not telling that you can go and start doing this already, but take this learning, and maybe if it is applicable to you and if you can really think about this change in your workplace, then you can try this out. So session-based test management, and you might be wondering what MBTS is. This is for the managers. Some of them think that, okay, you're wasting my time by telling me you will test only in sessions. What about the other time? What are you doing? So this term is for them. This is management-based test sessions. They know that we are also managing these sessions and not just wasting the other time that we have. So it demands for us to understand what this mission is before we even start testing. So for example, you have a web application which you have to test. You start with the URL testing, you type it, and then you automate it, and then it appears on the screen, and then you click on it, then you go back, click back button, or there is something else that you want to do. So for example, if you have this, and then first what you need to do is state the mission, what you want to do. If you just want to perform functional testing, or if you want to perform load testing or something else, you state that mission, and then you're time bound. You know that you're going to finish this. We'll call it duration and not time. You know that you have some allotted time. It can be from 15 minutes slots to 30 minutes or 45 minutes or 1 hour, 2 hour, depending on how far you can go and when you want to stop. And these are maintained in something known as session logs. Can I give it to my client? Is this the question that is running in your head? Anybody has this question? Anyone? Okay. So session log is something which you capture, and it could be in a notepad as well. You state the mission, and then you state start date, end date, start time and end time, that is the duration, and then you start capturing what you observe, what you see, and if there are any bugs, you note the bug ID and capture these bugs there. And then at the end of the designated time, you stop testing, and then you do something called as debriefing. How many of us eat even when we are full? I want to know. Please speak up. Nobody, right? So why are we even testing for 4 hours, 8 hours at a stretch, and without even putting our thinking into these tests that we are doing? This was the approach that even I followed for 7 years, from 2005 up until 2012. I ran the tests that were written by others, and I was so frustrated. I wanted to do something on my own, and I did get a chance to do, and I did present that, see, these are the bugs which I found which were not in the test cases. First question: how did you find it? Who told you to find it? That was the second thing. Then it went to the client. Then the client asked, why was it not found earlier? Because what the others were trying to do was, they're following the test cases, they provided the same inputs. Obviously, they got the expected result, which was noted. So here it gives you a scope to understand what you're trying to do. And also after, when you're full eating, what you want to do. You want to let your body convert this food into energy, right? So all that learning that we are taking, we want to convert into knowledge and share this wisdom with others. So shouldn't we think that we should allow ourselves to let this learning seep in and then learn something else? Or what else can we do with this session log is, it is a reflection of what a tester knows and doesn't know. So as you are performing the test with this mission that you have set early on, so you might find that there is a security issue, or you are role playing as a blind user and you see that there is an accessibility issue, but you don't know how to further test it. So you may want to take a note of that and say that, this is what I want to learn, if in case I want to become an expert, if I want to become a security tester or accessibility tester. So halt there and make a note of this in your session notes. So testing is not just, you know, as your manager says, you are trying to do this and then by the end of the day you complete it and go back home and you get your pay and that's it. But most of the testers that I speak to have been telling me that, you know, just they're so bored of testing. They're doing the same thing over and over again. How many of us feel here that we are doing the same thing? Anybody here? Few of us. I think this batch needs to speak up. So how many of us really think that testing can be fun? Even I was in a situation where I thought that it's so boring, I'm doing what the test cases that are run by others and I'm not having scope to do my own thing. So that's when this came to my rescue and I started doing testing by setting a mission. And then I followed the steps that were, you know, that I wanted to follow and not something which is there in the test case. We are not capturing the test steps here. So yeah, why do you want to do that? This is an important question that I have for all of you. So do you also think that a developer also is given a guide and he follows it and, you know, does the same thing over and over again and he repeats it? What he has is requirement specs, as you said. Similarly, we also need to, you know, move to that level where we are not spoon-fed. Like a new tester comes and everybody says, okay, let's give KT to him, let him follow the test. Why? Yes, it's of course time saving. Yes, it is. But also you need to give this tester to learn on his own and give a scope for him, give a meaning to why he's even in this organization and what he's trying to do. So take that boredom away from him by giving something for him to test in his own way rather than telling him what to test, give him that purpose, that is the mission. Why are we testing this? How this information is valuable to the client or the user. So what we are trying to do is we are being taught that, you know, textbooks are our knowledge sources. So you have been schooled that way and when you come to your workplace, you still want to be, you know, educated in a similar way. This was a revelation for me. You know, I don't want to be still schooled. I want to learn it myself and this was an approach that was like an eye-opener for me where I still didn't want to be given some books and told, you know, this is your limitation, you stick to the syllabus and not beyond the syllabus because the questions will come only from this. So that's not the way. If you want to learn and do things beyond, you know, what is there in the test cases, you also should equip yourself and be skilled to do those kind of test. So that is where this comes into picture. So what else can your session notes be? So at the end of 45 minutes or 90 minutes that you want to test, you have tested and you have, you know, captured all the necessary information that you want to put it there. And there could also be an observation that you made and you have captured it. What you want to do about that? You want to go back and investigate it. How many of us in that 8-hour stretch that you have given in the last 2 days of your, you know, agile sprint will, you know, want to investigate? But it's not my job because I have executed the test case. There is green and red. You have the results. Pass or fail. We are done for the day. And we don't even go and investigate it further because we don't have that time. So here, use these notes not just to execute those tests, but understand where are you or where do you stand as a tester. So as I said, you are performing this testing based on a mission. So stick to that mission during those 90 minutes that you want to test for. And then after that 90 minutes ends, you have also made a note of few things which you don't know, which you wish to know, which you wish to further investigate and learn further. You can also use it as a basis for your learning. Any questions here? Anybody? Yeah. We'll get to that in per your requirement. So during the first 13 days of the stint, before you even get the build to test, you prepare for what needs to be tested. So you, instead of writing test cases, what you do is you capture your test ideas, what you want to test about. So in a sprint, say for example, if you want to test subscription or unsubscription, so your mission could be that, you know, test the subscription for this page, sprint based. Unless and until you're using this, you know, somewhere else out of your workplace for your own learning, then the scope can differ, then the mission can differ. Exactly. So that is what exploratory testing is about. You're not limiting yourself some tests after you have completed running a few set of tests, and then do regression tests, and then do integration tests, etc. Here you are approaching or looking at the product as a whole, as you rightly pointed out. So with that vision and plus this mission that you have, you approach to it. Well said. I want a clap for this girl. You know, this brings me to the next line again. So after this, I'll get to what you just said. So why do we have to debrief? As I said, that once we are full, we need to stop eating and then give some time for our body to digest and convert all this food into energy. So the session note can serve as all of this. It is also your bug report. Did anyone have any questions regarding what you can do with this session note? So your bugs also go into this report. It can also serve as an investigation report. Your observations, questions also go in here, which you can later take it up with the client. So the session notes, you also make a note of, say for example, bug one. Like a journey, you're going through the product. What are the wow factors? You make a note of that. As a tester, I don't think you should only be critiquing your product. You know, if there's something good that you want to take and implement in another product, make a note of that as well. So what do you learn by this? I know that as a tester, you're allowed to only log bugs, and you have a system to log bugs, and you're paid to log bugs, and nobody is paid to log a wow factor, right? But it is a learning for us. Take this learning and implement it in some other projects where you can, you know, see that I saw the subscription working so beautifully here. When I clicked on this page, it worked like this, and it had a beautiful message for me as a user. When I clicked, I was given information on, you know, I have subscribed now with this email ID, and my subscription is valid from so and so. So these are some information which you found by testing, and you thought it was good to be implemented elsewhere as well. So you capture them. But the main focus, of course, is for you to, by the end of this note, you have a bug reported, which you may want to transfer into your bug reporting tool. We could do that. And it could also serve as an experience report, because you're not only capturing the bugs, but also the questions that you have and what else you want to further investigate. All this goes into the notes. And debriefing can also, like, this is just, I'm talking from one tester perspective. Imagine that there are other testers in your, you know, team who are testing the other aspects of the product. It could be a different page or the same page. Or you could be pair testing, that is testing together, and you both of you come with different ideas. So you can try that out, and then you can also build your domain knowledge while working together. And did any of you have this question? Is it applicable for, you know, a big project? Can I still try it? Or my domain is different, can I still try SBTM? So the answer is left to you. You can try and answer it for yourself on whether you want to really try it out. And if you are in an agile mode of working, then it becomes easy for you to even try it out. And just don't have to follow this, but it's up to you to do your own thing and it suits you, and that is what is agility for being agile. So after you've learned this, if you still want to learn more about it, here are a few links that you can go to and learn more about it. These are just random links that I've taken from the top results from Google, but if you want to learn further, you can read that and get to know more. And in 2012, as I said, I was introduced to this world of testers. Until then, my knowledge sources were so limited to my immediate test lead, test manager, and the documents that they provided. It kind of blocked me also from the outside world. Like, you know, you have this document here, you read it, you understand, and that's it. But then when I got to know that there is a world of testers outside who is, you know, every day adding on to this science of testing, that you can learn from them as well. So I was also told by a friend of mine that, you know, you can use social media as a learning medium, where you can, as a knowledge source, even on Facebook or Twitter, wherever, if you follow or subscribe to, you know, right resources, you can get to learn more about what you intend. Bernice is someone who has tried it actually in her organization, and she's written this article on how she tried and introduced this into her team. So this is the link. Maybe you can try and check if you can do so. Any questions? This is not the last slide. Anything at all? We are waterfalling even as we are calling ourselves agile. So I agree with that. Yes. So what I tend to do is something called test early. But when people hear about this, they wonder, what is test early? What is test early, by the way? As by the role, you are a tester. So what do you wish to do in the first day 1 to day 13? In, you know, what are your roles and responsibilities as a tester? Can someone please pick up? Somebody else, not you. I'll just take 5 minutes of yours to explain what test early means to me. So when I've been given the requirements, I also am equally responsible for the product quality. So I also test the requirements if there is something confusing which I don't understand. So it's time that, you know, don't let just the developers to be asking all the questions to the client. You also are in the team and you can contribute as well. So let's not limit ourselves to the role. Just because we've been, you know, given this role of a tester, let's not limit ourselves to that role. But also test your requirements and then log all these questions. I follow something what is known as the clarification log, where I capture all these questions and it is always shared with the client. So whenever they can come back and fill in this Excel sheet which is shared with them. So there half of my work is done. And then we start capturing the test ideas. So before that, you mentioned about design. So we also need to find those bugs early on. Why wait until for the design to be, you know, incorporated and then, you know, log 10 bugs and wow, you know, this guy has done a great job, but it's of no use until we wait, you know, for the next sprint for all these changes to be fixed. So why not do it early? That is what I mean by test early. So test the design as well. You can ask for the wireframe. You can ask them, you know, where as soon as they design that page, ask for the A and B prototyping as well. You can also make those decisions. But if you develop those skills and mindset in order to help this team, you know, why wait until for the product to be, you know, deployed in test environment for us to start acting like a tester? So let's test early, right from the requirement phase, design phase, and then even coding. You can contribute. There are many who are interested in coding as well. So you can contribute at that stage. And then when you come to test, what do you do? I want to know, what do you do in coding and planning? So you're testing in these sessions. Okay, here's an interesting point. He said that whatever clarifications he has, he completes them all answered in coding and planning. Don't you think as you learn and grow with the product, you'll have new questions? So this is where the idea of, you know, the traditional versus exploratory testing. I'm not telling that this is new. It's been there since ages. Most of us were already born by then. So as you said, will you not have further questions as the product grows and matures? Definitely when, you know, you're integrating with other systems, you'll have different questions. Should it be here? You know, like a back button. I'm using this Airtel dongle at home. And from there are three pages, and this back button is placed in the top right hand corner on the first two pages, and then on the third page it is somewhere else. So as a user, I just want to, you know, go to page 1 and 2 at times, and page 3 has not yet been used. Like, I don't want to even go to page 3. But the day I went to page 3, I realized that the back button is placed somewhere else. So it's like, you know, you're accustoming the user to click your, you know, click on far right hand corner, and then on the third page suddenly it is somewhere else. So this revelation came up when I tried to do something different after a few days. So I can have such clarifications coming in at any time. So that's why we have this clarification log, and which is shared with the client. You can answer at a time of their convenience. So did that answer your question? Have a specific question, maybe you can rephrase it. Okay, now before we go to interviews, I come to what you said. So, how many of you are in a QA team, or you yourself are called QA? Please raise your hands high or both again. Quite a few. So are you all testers as well? Is it a silly question to ask? I feel yes, it is a silly question to ask, because quality assurance, that's what QA stands for, right? So why testers only are the quality assurance? This is my question to you all. Why only testers are the quality assurance? Here he is introducing another term, gatekeeper. Right? So it's a very challenging job, right? It's not an easy job. So you all agree that testing is not an easy job? Anymore? back to, you know, we are in an automation testing conference and we are talking about all this. And I recently thought about this fact that when there is some error and the newspapers or the media projects it as a computer glitch, why is it so? Why is it not a human error? What is a computer glitch? Anybody? Have you ever wondered what glitches and why it is associated with computers when actually it is a human error? Does this make sense? Exactly. Super. Any more ideas? So what you are doing is, you know, example, a very specific example for this would be a drop down. So when a tester is testing this, what he checks is against something which you think as, you know, for a gender example, you have male and female and you see it and then you pass it. The same thing a script does. It sees that male and female. What does it do? What have you captured as, you know, input values or what you should see as expected outcome? It sees for it. But when a tester, a thinking tester, like everybody is a thinking tester. Recently, Paul Seaman wrote an article on how we should not differentiate testers as thinking testers and non-thinking testers because we all are thinking testers. So what do? When we test, we don't look for, you know, gender as male and female. We also want to, you know, capture other genders. So we add this value which is not there in, you know, in your script. And then what if your drop down is so long that, say for example, select country and you have a list of long list of countries. So what happens when a user is there and he sees this page and he wants to select a country? He sees that it's a long list. What does your script or the machine does? Does it see it's so long and then, you know, I have to scroll further down? It, you know, the machine is doing it versus a human is doing it. That is, a real person is checking. So he sees something which the machine doesn't see, right? How many of you agree to this? Raise hands. So should we also have these roles like exploratory testers or these skill sets? This is the example that I could come up with. Is there anybody else who can come up with any other examples, similar examples? I recently was attending a session and I'd like to draw this and show. This was So I was attending a conference and there was a talk about designing, and this lady, she was presenting, she had 15 years of experience in designing, and she showed us this website wherein there was, you know, a username field and a password field and a submit field. This was A, and similarly there was a username, password, and there was another field. Here instead of submit, there was something called mustache. This is not something which we can train somebody else, you know, to look and agree to whether this is good or bad, whether it should be scripted. We can't script few things. So what we also need to inculcate and develop is these, you know, mindsets that when you say you are a tester, you are also adding some value which is the reflection of yours in the product. So when you're testing and you see that few things are getting fixed in the product and then you see the final product, you see that yes, I contributed this. So you also get that, you know, that genuine value add that you're presenting. In this case, why I gave this example is because I was testing an application which was being developed for dancers, and we had this similar kind of, you know, login page wherein we said username, password, and instead of submit, we conducted another A-B test like this, and instead of submit we said let's dance. So this was a page which was being designed for dancers who enter dance competition, and they have to log in, and all that they'll do after logging is enroll for this competition. So, you know, when you say let's dance, that brings the dancer close to this domain, or instead of rather saying submit, if you add less chance, it does bring a different value. So these are something which you will understand when you start thinking from your own perspective rather than, you know, script or execute tests that are written by others. You may not agree with me now, but when you see the result of this, and as a dancer, if you really tend to get to use this application, then you'll see the difference. Okay. And how many of you have managers who tell that, you know, by the end of this sprint, I want 0-1? Anybody? I have had such managers growing up as a tester. Nobody? You're all lucky. The end result of a software is not a perfect software, and here is someone who proves it. I don't know if you have heard about Freeman Dyson. Can you guys read this? One of you volunteer to come up and read this. This is something, you know, very important which Freeman had to say. I need a volunteer to come up and read this. Anybody? Take the mic, please. Minutes of your patience. Yeah, please come over. There was very intense. Yeah, please read it.
So, the role of failure. You can't possibly get a good technology going without an enormous number of failures. It's a universal rule. If you look at bicycles, there were thousands of weird models built and tried before they found the one that really worked. You could never design a bicycle theoretically. Even now, after we have been building them for 100 years, it's very difficult to understand just why a bicycle works. It's even difficult to formulate it as a mathematical problem. But just by the trial and error, we found out how to do it, and the error was essential.
Did you guys get the sense out of this? Did it even make any sense? So what we are told, thank you so much, your name?
Deepshika.
Thank you, Deepshika. I just handled it. So when we are told, you know, you have to test this or build this product, we all are given some set of requirements and we are, you know, running towards getting it right the first time, building the right product. You've heard this defense, right? Verification and validation, a very famous question in most of the interviews. So all, and think for a while on what, you know, success means to us and what failures means to each of us. Whatever it means, we know that, you know, we all are here for a learning and not just take our paychecks and go. We could be doing anything for that matter. So let's halt and think over, you know, what we are here for and what should we be even doing when we hear the term zero bugs or a perfect software. So there's really no such thing. Yes, you are progressing always. So you're not halting. You are on the path of progress, but there is no such thing as zero bugs. So the question to you guys: so the next time when you hear zero bugs, what will your answer be? Sorry. So this is a mathematician who is still alive. What will your answer be? I want to really know. Because these are some things which are not taught in school, and you are answerable to your managers, and they will ask you this question. Yes. Right. Right. Some people are even buying the stuff that is doing the rounds on internet. ourselves as testers. It's in our capability to also educate this client, because client is just one perspective of what you see as a product. It could be the product owner or anybody. But as a tester, when you yourself develop the skills or mindsets of from testing on different perspectives, you're more than one person. It could be role playing as a hacker one day who could be extensively testing for security issues. And let's not limit ourselves when we call ourselves as testers to functional testing. Let's build this capability, you know, that provides quality. When we say quality, it's not just, you know, sticking to the requirement document. There are several things that goes uncaptured in your requirement document. Coming to testing is an easy job. When I joined the testing, I was told that even a 10th fail or a pass could also perform testing. So I think what were they thinking when they said testing is an easy job? I think I want to learn from you all what you think comprises of best testing time. Any answers? I just need 3 answers. Yeah. When you say, when you estimate, you take time to test. One day, I took time out to actually write down what testing time meant for me and what all it covered. So this is quite clumsy, so I'll open up each of these notes here. So in the project phase, that is day 1 to 13, what you're supposed to be doing or what you're doing and which you're not conveying it to your manager, so they assume that you're free, is all this. You're testing, of course, yes, but you're also testing the requirements. How many of you have tested requirements? I think most of you have, right? So, but you forget to tell or convey that you're also investing your time and effort in this. So why I'm telling all this is because when you next time go and estimate, when you're sitting in a sprint planning meeting, when you say, I need 2 hours to do this or 4 hours to do this, your manager should also be educated and they should know that you need also your time and effort invested in all of these activities, so that they know that testers can be used on 4 or 5 different projects in a single sprint, but rather use all 15 days of your time to do all of this. Most of you are automation testers here, right? When you call yourself as the automation testers, I think you also learn what the limitations of the tools are. You do learn, right? And what you're doing when you're using the tool, you're also testing the tool, right? Say for example, if you're testing the tool and you found a limitation, you want to speak to somebody who developed this tool and you want to communicate with them. Do you also capture that as your testing time? Most of the time it gets lost. You think that it's out of my role or responsibility to do this, so let me alter this or just stick to what I'm doing. But it's not so. These are few things which you have to, you know, make a note of, unless and until you set your mind to, you know, write down what you do as a tester, these things may get lost. So this is when I took time out to understand that, you know, these are other things that I'm doing as a tester which I'm not telling my manager or I'm forgetting to tell them. And this is a trend which is followed from ages. I don't know, many people who let their testers do more than test execution and test case preparation or automation and writing scripts. So there's much more that you do other than all of this. You're also clarifying your assumptions while you're doing this. And while testing, you also do these activities. Learning and interaction also is a part of this. So do you also tell that, you know, you want to further investigate, so you need time for that and you're also learning. But do we convey this all and get estimated properly? All this while we are being guesstimating and giving some random numbers. How many hours do you want to test? We say 8 hours, 4 hours, 2 hours. But let us consider this when we next test, so that, you know, we are well aware of, and the team or the next generation of testers doesn't blame you because you forgot to capture all this. And the interactions are very much essential. It could be anyone from your client to the product owner to the user itself. I know a friend of mine who invites users, random users into our organization, and she captures the emotions or the feelings that they are exhibiting when they are testing a product. Are they annoyed? Are they happy? Or are they sad? She calls it emotional testing. But whatever name you, you know, label it, you are interacting with a real user here. And while you wait for a feedback to appear on your Play Store and then realize, you know, instead ask for an immediate feedback by doing this. This is also very much part of testing. And when I said knowledge sources, let's not limit it to our immediate lead manager, client, etc., but go beyond and seek other reliable references. So when I speak about this, I recall an instance where I was testing with Tesco on ISBN. So there was this website which quoted that, you know, starting from this digit to this digit, then you can use it for books or other products. I could find there was an error on, you know, in that page itself. So it was a third party tool. We were testing it and we could see that, you know, your product while you are doing all this testing. You don't have to limit to your requirements because it's not stated in the requirements. I'm not capturing as a bug. It's not so. So today also when I was at the bug bash, there are a lot of people who came in and logged bugs, not against Selenium, but on third-party tools as well. How is this helping us all? If those bugs get fixed, then you can as well start using Selenium on different browsers and different versions. So let's try and, you know, build our capabilities to an extent that we are not limiting ourselves but extending it to learn more. And learning, attending conferences is also your testing time. Here, I think you all have been marked present and not absent today. So this is very much part of testing time. And here is time for an experiment. I need two volunteers. Any two of you to come over. Anybody who would like to volunteer? Two of you, yeah. One more. You are a tester? We need a programmer. A role play. So here it how it goes. So we have a tester and a programmer. They are not facing each other, and they are given a requirement document. And here they are trying to, you know, convert it into readable code. If it's a programmer, and if it's a tester, he's trying to resolve it. And while they are doing it, they are not talking to each other. So this is iteration one. And one of you can sit. Both of you can sit. Away from each other. So you guys are, you did read this exercise, right? So I'll read it out for you in case if you haven't read it. Tester gets a drawing which needs to be replicated. Tester tells the programmer what to draw all at a time, and programmer draws this. There's no talking during coding. Tester tests drawing and the programmer fixes the bug. We need a paper and a pen as well. Anybody here? So you can come closer. You want to hear what she's saying. conducted this experiment in at Eurostar and StarWest, and there was a revolution which people could see. I hope the audiences are not getting bored, but you can come forward and see what's happening. So here is the first picture. You need to explain this to him, and he has to capture this. Later, you'll get to test this, and you'll report back. You'll tell all this in one go, so that he understands it and captures it. Yes. Where they appear, how they appear, and how close is his code to your understanding. Anybody else who wants to participate, we have another picture. Why are we doing this exercise, anybody? Anyone? So what happens when a tester is not involved right from the beginning? So you get to see the results soon. So now I think you're coming to understand why it's important for us to be involved in all meetings and ask those right questions when it's supposed to be asked. And most of the time, the manager tells, you know, since you're free, why don't you get into another project and start doing something else. So this is just for us to realize that, you know, we are also as much involved in a project right from phase one until phase N, and not just, you know, testing. So our role need not be, again, limited to what we call ourselves or whatever SQA, QA, quality engineer, SDET. Let's just not limit ourselves to this role and stick to what we are repeatedly doing. We are setting a wrong example for our future generation of testers. Many of them, you know, even I read it recently on, I think it was on a blog, yeah. It was by Lalit. He runs the magazine called Tea Time with Testers, and he wrote it on his blog that, you know, who becomes a tester? Who are these people who want to do testing, and why they want to do testing? It's basically someone who's been developing for a while and is agitated, frustrated, you know, long hours at work, and now thinks that testing is so easy that they want to do testing. That was one of the examples that he gave. The other example was a lady who has gone on maternity leave and she wants to come back, and she thinks testing is so easy that she wants to do it. There was this other person who had a computer degree and they didn't know, you know, to code, but they thought that testing was the next best choice. Or they thought that, you know, you can make money while you're doing all this by not putting extra effort or as much effort as you think should be done. Another example. So we as, you know, test leaders or testers need to break these notions. And why are we not paid as, you know, equals with developers? I myself have seen, you know, it could be some random number for developers. And even testers hesitate to go up to that number and say that, you know, this is my experience and I need this number. What is your role, developer? What are you earning, some number? When they assume that it's required for me to ask 2 lakhs less than that. So let's not, you know, degrade ourselves. Let's respect this profession that we are in. And let's learn to, you know, educate our future generation of testers to know what it actually is and what we should be doing. And there are several test leaders around the world who are already started doing this work. I know few people from India and abroad as well who are, you know, trying to do this. They're not doing this because their role entitles them to do it, and they're not doing this because they want to, you know, be famous, but they think that it is their responsibility to set a good example. So was this in any way useful to you guys? doesn't mean that I personally have gone through these experiences, because I didn't give scope for myself to undergo this torture. I was a rebel since 2005 till today. So when I suggested some, you know, changes, or when someone told me to do this, I did question. So questioning is so important. Say for example, I was new in the team and I was asked to perform some, or do some performance testing. And the lead gave me some instructions. It was a room full of 50 people and nobody asked a question, because they thought that this is coming from a lead and we all should follow this instruction. Yeah, but there are some people who love questioning. And why do they love questioning? Because they want to know more. And what do they do with knowing more? What makes you, you know, when you know more, what it makes you? It makes you wiser, right? So it could be that. Or it could be, you know, you don't, also there are several books and videos and TED Talks on questioning and how you should question, how should you ask questions. So why I'm giving so much importance to questions is because testing is about questioning the product that you are, you know, which is under test. Why you are questioning? In order to seek information. Why do you need this information? To present to your client or anybody who needs this information. That's all. You're in the job of information business, wherein you're collecting and giving. So while you're doing this, you know, don't be scared that, you know, should I do this or shouldn't I do this. You're looking, you know, you're looking at a product only as, you know, to enhance the quality of it. So let's not fear or, you know, be overcome by any kind of hesitation to question. So if you feel that questioning makes you vulnerable or something, you know, many people think that if I ask question, maybe I may be tagged as someone bold and unapproachable or something else that you might have fears within. So there are a lot of things on the internet which you can read and understand, like some tech talk, art of asking. This is one tech talk. So it's beautifully explained on how you should be approaching in several books written on it. So question and then do. Just don't do. You had a question. Encourage questioning. When someone questions, right. And questioning, we also, you know, classic example is the Bhagavad Gita. Arjuna learnt a lot because he questioned Krishna on what, you know, what is the, that he's trying to tell. He had a lot of questions like that. So his intention was not to, you know, gauge or measure the level of intelligence of Krishna, but to learn himself. So this is what we need to, you know, make sense out of when you question. You are not hurting your feelings, nor we are measuring your, you know, your success or failure. This is what happens in interviews a lot of the time. So you're called in for an interview, and people, the interviewers need to be skilled, you know, to know that, you know, we are not critiquing here, or I'm not allowing you to, you know, feel low or high, keep myself high. So that is worthy of another talk, I guess, about interviews. I think the time is can we see the picture, please? Okay, you didn't see. Oh my god. So you have to now report the bug.
So this is correct. This is, you have not completely got it yet, right? This is correct. This is correct.
This is your perspective of what quality is. Let us call somebody else. Mark the bug, please. Mark it differently so that we know which is yours. So again, why I said it's her perspective of quality, because she's seeing from the skills, experience and the knowledge she has. Here is somebody who thinks high of, you know, what we see on the What is discomfort to you? That doesn't mean that has to be a discomfort for me. So the meaning of quality can differ from each person. Somebody can, you know, even fail all of the tests over there. Thank you guys. Thank you for your active participation. All for staying till the end. Really appreciate it. So what testing means to me is when I recently attended a session myself in at Starry. There were three testing gurus, Michael Bolton, James Back and John Back, the Back brothers. And they told me that you have to videotape yourself while you're testing. I say, you know, should I really even be doing that? And how does that add value to what I'm doing as a tester? Told me that try videotaping yourself. Look at your, you know, how you're utilizing that time in a session, for example. Are you entirely, you know, focused? But when I was in that session, I saw that there was a lot of disturbance even to these three great gurus. A lot of people were, you know, kept disturbing and distracting them, and how they managed it. And why my last slide captures these points? I really want you to guys to not just do testing, but perform testing. So when I say perform testing, you also make a note of what you are trying to do. Try to put it in words. Example, like I'm standing here and I ask you a question. Say for example, what is exploratory testing? I get some answers. If I ask an yes or no question, people mostly say yes or no. Say I've given you two options, then you have to select yes or no, and then you do that. But when I tell you to write it down, you start thinking from a different, you know, you go in depth and you try capturing it. So here's something that I did. I still have 2 minutes, so I think I can do this. I kept it to the end because I didn't want to bore you guys right in the beginning. So when I start, when I thought that I am coming for this workshop, and you know, even before I start preaching about exploratory testing, I should know what it is for myself. And here is a note that I made for myself on what exploratory testing means to me. And I take this opportunity to read this out to you all. So here is what I have written. Explore the system under test with an intention to learn about the product. Learn by using the product as a user. Learn by questioning the status quo of the product. Learn by challenging the status quo of the product. Learn to make sense out of the product. Learn about who will, who can, who must and should, who would have used, who could use the product, and how, why, when, where, how else can they use it, why not, and when and where else can they use this product under test. So are we even thinking so much when you're performing testing, or are we just running the script, or, you know, trying to perform, you know, read out the test steps and just mark pass and things? So there's so much more to you in the role of a tester that you can do. And this not just adds value to you, your profession, but in the eyes of you yourself, you can grow as a stronger leader or as a tester. There's more that I've written. If you want, I maybe can share it with you in, on Twitter or elsewhere where you can read about it. So the intention of this slide was for you to realize that you are not doing testing, but you are actually performing testing, do this while you do that. Observe every activity that you perform as a tester. Note it. Because you need to convey it to someone, right? Question it. Whatever you do, question yourself before even someone else questions your work. Why did you do this? Why did you perform this kind of testing? Or why did you miss out this? Why was this found in production and not here and now? Do what's relevant, and please don't do what's irrelevant. It's such a big time waster. So if you feel that it's not in the scope of what you're doing, as and when you learn and try and capture all this, you will also learn that what should not be done and what you should not be preaching others to do. Find it and please share it with others so they can learn from your learning instead of they themselves coming.